Welcome to the October 21st, 2019 regular meeting of City Council. Could the clerk call the roll, please?
Cobb.
Here.
Dunbar.
Here.
Rowe.
Here.
Saren.
Here.
Stein. Unger.
Here.
Yasinal. Five present, Your Honor.
We have two people not here, one for religious reasons, the other one for personal family business, so they'll be excused. The minutes of the regular council meeting from Monday, October 7th, 2019, will be approved with corrections. At this point, I would like to tell you about a change in the agenda as printed, in that agenda item number 5, the Evans Energy presentation, is going to go before personal communications from citizens. Also, for informational purposes, both pieces of legislation tonight are on first reading. So I will turn it over to Joe McRae.
Good evening, Joe McRae, Director of Parks and Recreation. Happy to be with you all tonight. Proud of the work that was done on this, our energy efficiency project. We're fortunate to have Mr. Jeff Evans here to talk about the project. It's a $6 million project that entailed a collaboration with Spectrum Energy, with Evans Energy, with the County Office of Sustainability and the city in order to make infrastructure improvements that will reduce energy usage and fund itself through the savings. And so we're proud of the work that was done. 2 years of a very complex work that I think was done very well. And without further ado, we will have Mr. Evans come in and give you some more details about that.
Good evening. Do you want comments held till the end or throughout? Or questions?
How about at the end?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Jeff Evans with Evans Energy. Thank you for selecting our firm to do the energy project for the city. And it's 2 years have gone by, so just it went by fast. So I'd like to just walk you through some of the things that we did throughout the project. It was a challenge, I'll have to say that. We got into some older equipment, older buildings, but we overcame the challenges. Just a review, the energy and maintenance costs were the objective, and we achieved that. Maintenance cost was on the upward trend, had some older systems that were continuing to fail, and those costs were continuing to rise. Wherever we could, we applied green solutions, and that doesn't always work for every building. It works certainly in lighting and energy management systems. We replaced some very old equipment and some equipment that just had reached its useful life. So by doing that, we are offsetting future capital projects. So a lot of this project helped fund capital projects that city won't have to worry about for, in some cases, 20, 25, 30 years before you'll ever have to worry about some of these capital projects again. Hmm. And being good stewards of the city's resources. Citywide, we upgraded internal lighting, almost 3,500 lamps were retrofitted with LED, and so that reduced, in most cases, I'll get a little bit engineering nerdy on you, we have a lot of 4-foot lamps throughout this building, 4-foot fluorescents. Those went from 32 watts down to 11, so that's a 60, almost 2/3 reduction in wattage, and yet we still have adequate lighting. 1,600 traffic signals were retrofitted to LED throughout the city. And again, the same thing, the wattage was reduced dramatically. And just another comment, we won't have to worry about those lamps because they have long life lamps. The LEDs are 3 times longer than traditional lights. In this building, if you notice this picture, there was problems with solar heat gain in the summertime in the atrium. It would just get so hot out there that the air conditioning couldn't keep up. So by adding a product by 3M, we added window film and we reduced that temperature in the atrium quite a bit. A lot of this, it's hard to see this, but that is a 1950 style thermostat in the service garage. I'm sorry. So this was a 1950s style thermostat that, this box here is full of controls that were approaching 35, 40 years old. And a lot of it is antiquated. So it's now all been upgraded to digital and everything's monitored on a central system now, central computer. Some of these boilers dated back to early 1960s. Just inefficient, it was time for an upgrade, and many of the new boilers now are such that we're at 95% efficiency. These boilers were probably 60% efficient at best on a good day. We replaced the metal roof on the north rink, where it was literally the north rink metal roof was sliding off. It had moved 6 inches. And it was in a failure mode. So that roof was replaced with a 20-year warrantied roof. So we won't have to worry about that roof for 20 years. It was all insulated, brought up to the latest energy codes. And just a reminder, that was a Garland product. Garland is Cleveland, a local Cleveland roofing company. Brook Park Roofers did the work. All the air conditioning equipment was upgraded to Carrier, bought locally. Some of the other installation work was done by Tremco over here in Beechwood. There was a great deal of effort to use local firms. This is another shot of the old South Rink windows, and I know it may be hard to see, but the wood had rotted, and it was no longer weatherproof. That was all weatherized and replaced. This is a shot of the old 1968 ice maker for the South Rink. It had just seen its time, and it was time for an upgrade, so we essentially replaced that with new technology. Overall, citywide, we replaced 800 tons of cooling. That's equivalent to 320 homes. And again, that was all upgraded to the most energy efficient Carrier equipment made. It's hard to see, but there was water damage at the community center from roof leaks, and there was water damage starting to happen in the north rink just due to we had a loose building, we had leaks in the roof, we had a dehumidifier that didn't work, and so once all those things were corrected, we saw the mold go away. The wet spots went away. And so we preserved a building that's going to last another 30 years. This was a picture of a 300, maybe not 300, but a large water heater that was above the gym floor. It did leak at one point before the project, and we drained it down, abandoned it, and intentionally moved it to the back of the building. So if it ever leaks, it won't leak on the gym floor. So we tried to do things like that that were proactive. May not, we picked up some efficiency on that one, but the real goal was, let's not ruin the gym floor. This is, again, a shot of the old compressors. Mark Vasiloff, who's since retired, said one of these would go every summer, and it cost about $50,000 to replace. We now have compressors that have 5-year warranties on the compressors, and their expected life will be 25 to 30 years. So that problem was eliminated. Other thing, too, was that machine was also R22. R22 has been banned. It's a chlorofluorocarbon. It's not good for the atmosphere. We went back to ammonia, which is carbon neutral. And that was a green solution, so to speak. This is the old dehumidifier. It was replaced. It was in a failure mode. It could not heat the North Rink. It could not dehumidify. And it caused water problems and some mold issues, which we corrected. First Energy called Joe McCray and said, something's wrong. We're going to come out and check your meter because it's just not where it's supposed to be. Well, we saw this trend right away in the electric usage. It dropped last summer dramatically. So we saw about a 50% reduction on just the community center. And again, that was the goal, was to reduce energy and reduce maintenance cost. And so this chart sort of predicts, shows the baseline, what the city was spending 2 years ago versus what the city is spending today on energy and maintenance cost. The environmental impact of all the things we've done, which have been awesome, is almost 3,000 metric tons of carbon emissions that the city has eliminated. It would be equivalent to 500 and almost 600 vehicles that are taken off the road and equal to 3,300 acres of forest. So a lot of good things were done, and it's good for the environment. So Cleveland Heights is on its way to becoming a smarter city. So that's all I have. If there are any questions?
Comments, questions from any? Buddy on council.
I'm glad you're doing it.
Councilperson Theron.
Just a quick question. I know that we determined not to pursue solar for any of our buildings in this particular project. But while this
just
was
speak into the mic a little, we can't hear.
While this was going on, did you see any opportunities for further projects potentially that would introduce use of virtual net metering or anything like that? Should we be allowed to do that by the power company?
Go ahead.
Sorry about that. Joe McCray, Parks and Rec. That's a great question. In this week's packet, the city manager talked about phase two, which is actually looking at solar for the roofs. There were actually individuals on the roofs of some of our city buildings last week looking at potential options and feasibility for doing so. So that work is beginning now. But that would be a different Joe managing that project.
Did you have anything else?
Nope.
Anyone over here?
No.
No.
All right.
So this is more a question for Joe or perhaps Susanna, in terms of how would we have paid for all of this had we not entered into this agreement?
Well, I think the traditional way, and Susanna, feel free to jump in, is to go out for a bond, go out for debt service, and then try to pay it off. Funds are limited. These are all big-time capital projects. So you would be looking at $6 million in capital projects that we would have to go out to bond for and try to pay. So it was a great opportunity for the city, leverage a lot of things. I work in that community center. We got a lot of things addressed citywide, not just in the community center, but the community center is really nice. I'm not sure if we would have been able to afford it otherwise.
Yeah. Okay.
I also want to mention that this whole report will be on the website tomorrow. So residents will be able to go through it.
Susanna, I also have a slideshow of all the construction pictures. It takes about 10 minutes, but I understand.
If you could send that to us, we can put that online.
Your IT person has it.
Okay.
So
oh.
You're good to go.
Yeah. The more we have in terms of information, the better.
Okay.
So thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just for people's information also, in this week's council packet, which is available to anyone who wants to get it off the website, we have a whole timeline of this entire project in case you're into the detail. So, okay, we'll move now to comment, and we'll start on the over here, first row. First row over here. Anybody here to comment? In the first row. Okay.
My name is Mark Pultusker, 1275 Englewood Drive. I was going to comment on council's meeting Wednesday night, last Wednesday, concerning the demolition of the house next to mine, but unfortunately, the demolition itself has created issues that I think need to be talked about. Once again, I was not notified of the demolition that took place literally the next morning after that meeting Wednesday. I was sent an email saying it was being postponed pending the meeting. When I showed up at the property to do some work, I noticed two men standing in my driveway with a large hose across my lawn and my bushes, hosing down the demolition as they were doing it. I asked them who gave them permission to stand on my property, and they said, the city. I said, I don't know how the city can give you permission to stand on my property and string your hose across my grass and bushes. And they just laughed, so I called the police. The police came, and they said that they tell us the city gave permission, we can't do anything. Finally, Alan showed up, and he said, no, he never gave them permission. I said, then why weren't you here when they started? You're demolishing a house. There's asbestos in this house, there's lead. How do you know it's being done right? Why do I have to call the police? Then I asked him, why are they using the fire hydrant? Is that standard procedure? It's a private company. Who's paying for this? His response shocked me. He didn't know. Is this his first demolition that he didn't know if they should use it? Apparently, they shouldn't be using it because they came back Saturday and decided to do more demolishing without putting water on it. So I have all this dust and asbestos and lead just floating around. They didn't work on Sunday. They didn't work on Friday. So they did the demolition Thursday, didn't do work Friday, showed up Saturday without the water, didn't show up Sunday, didn't show up yesterday. Again, if the city's going to demolish a house, which generates all this stuff, someone should be watching it. And when I asked Alan, why wasn't I notified, he said, it's the contractor's responsibility. Then I asked him, who gave them the right to put all their stuff in my driveway? He said, well, we can't demolish the house otherwise. You're too close. I said, it's my property. I said, I went to redo my porch and I wanted to do something that the city didn't like, my response to the city wouldn't be, well, that's the only way I can do it, but that's the city's response to me, that, too bad. If you have to use my private property and don't ask, then you have to find a different way. Now, it'll cost more money, but you don't tell me you can't do it any other way and tough luck. So once again, it doesn't seem that city staff has really thought this process through. And in this case, I think presented very definite health issues. I've got tenants in that building on the first floor that have 2 3-year-olds. I had to run and close their windows because no one notified us. I had a tenant who was stuck in his house because he couldn't pull out of the driveway. And I have contractors who are laughing at me when I say, did I give you permission? The city did. So as Wednesday night, as Councilman Unger said, that council's job is simply to set policy and it's up to the city to implement it. For many, many times, I've tried to tell council, maybe you need to have a little more feedback and look into city staff and their actions and not just have 100% confidence that they're doing what you want to do. And this is a prime example of that. That demolition was pathetic. The fact that no one from the city showed up until I had to call the police, and then it turns out I'm right, and then they come on a Saturday and don't use the water, that's just pathetic. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Is Alan Butler here? Okay. Next.
He is here.
Hi, I'm Mallory.
Excuse me. Alan, would you be able to chat with him outside? Thank you.
I don't want to chat with Alan. I address City Council to deal with Alan. I stated the facts.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
So I'm here to talk about the removal of breed-specific legislation that's on the agenda. I'm happy to see that. I am a pit bull owner. I adopted a pit bull about 7 years ago. I like to tell people it ruined my life. The dog has absolutely ruined my life. I have a king-size bed, and he takes up the whole thing. I have to mute myself on conference calls because he snores all day long, even when he's awake. He smells so bad. When my son comes home from school, he runs past me and goes to say hi to the dog. And the first thing he says in the morning is, "Where's Gotti?" Not, "Hi, Mom." We moved to Cleveland Heights because we needed a big yard for our dogs. We lived in the warehouse district, and the apartment we were in wasn't working for our dogs. And we picked the house that we bought because it was the biggest yard we could find in Cleveland Heights. And that's why we live here. And we're not a strange family. It sounds really weird for people older than us, but catering our lives around our dogs is not something that is unique in millennial culture. So I'm really happy to hear that we're making Cleveland Heights more accessible for people with dogs, and I hope that this is just the first step. What I'm hoping that happens next is that you look at a really comprehensive plan to make Cleveland Heights much more accessible for dog owners in general. I'm not a certified dog trainer, but I grew up in a house of them, and my husband did too, and I grew up with Dalmatians after the 101 Dalmatians craze. Dalmatians are nuts. And people adopted them and then couldn't handle them. So my family took them in and we rehabilitated them and found new homes for them. And I realized that a lot of the behaviors people think are aggression in dogs are signs of anxiety or nervousness or fear. And I know that a tired dog and a mentally stimulated dog is a happy dog and is a safe dog. And a lot of the times when you see a dog that's exhibiting what we think is an aggressive behavior, they're scared, they're guarding their resources, they think that they're at risk, and they don't know any better. So I think that what we need is dog parks. We need resources at the city level to connect people with dog walkers, dog trainers. The Neighborhood Pet Resource Center in Slavic Village is an amazing resource. Something like that over here would be great. Connections to vets with discounted rates for people who are low income would be great. Pet waste receptacles. And then keeping in mind, if you hear pushback from people who oppose, having pit bulls in Cleveland Heights, remembering that the foundations of fears of pit bulls are rooted in racism, because we're not afraid of pit bulls, we're afraid of people who own pit bulls. So keeping that in mind as you're thinking about this legislation would be helpful. But thank you for taking this positive, proactive step, and I hope that it's just the first. And then next year we'll talk about allowing horses in Cleveland Heights, because that's ultimately why I live here. Thank you.
Thank you. I would point out that on this coming Sunday, October 27th at 11 a.m., the Cleveland Heights Dog Watcher Walker Watch Program invites all pup parents and their canines to celebrate autumn at the Halloween Bark in Kane Park at 11 a.m.
Thank you.
Okay, second row, starting over here. Anyone over here in the second row wanting to? Please come forward. Or would you like for us to? Would you like for us to move a mic over there to you? Okay.
I'm Chris Hall, and I live at 3000 Scarborough Road. The only thing I'm going to say at this point has to do with the severance mall. So, first of all, I gather we're going to vote or have a first hearing on it this evening. Is this
the first
right?
reading first of the legislation hearing. Only, not a vote.
Right. Mary said we were going to vote on it. but in any case, what I'd like to see happen is to have it made into one-story houses or houses with elevators, because the only place that I found that's acceptable to me is there was one house on North Park that was one story, and the house was not very appealing, but and someone else bought it. But there are no one-story houses in Cleveland Heights in areas that I find interesting. The second thing has to do with the cost of the study. I pay my taxes. I should be told how much you're planning on spending for the study.
That was Sydney.
There is a cost at the end of the study. It was $233,000 plus. If there were extra costs, it would be around $260,000.
I'm sorry. How much again?
$233,000 for the part of it, and then there were some extra expenses that got it up to $260,000. We'll be discussing it thoroughly next week at the committee of the whole meeting, and then deciding where to go from there.
Okay. I hope so. And really, it's really important to me. I know that the city wants money all the time, but it's the taxes are higher here than any place in Massachusetts, and I wonder how that could be. But they really are, including Lincoln, Massachusetts, which is has high taxes, but not as high as here. There's zero commercial zoning, zero. But really, I think if you could provide some options in the form of one-story houses that well built. I don't mean lightweight houses either, because there's no place else for them to go in Cleveland Heights. So, if there is any place else for them to go, I'd like to know about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments. So in the second row on this side over here, is there anybody wishing to speak?
Good evening, and thank you for giving us the time to speak. My name is Valerie Ross, and I'm a 15-year resident of Cleveland Heights. I live at 3460 Woodridge Road. I, along with my wife Hannah, who apologizes that she could not be here tonight, but she's rather sick, and none of us want us to be around her tonight. We own Sits and Wiggles Pet Care and Training. I'm also a certified professional dog trainer who's independently certified through the certification of professional dog trainers. The certification process is extensive and set up to ensure humane, ethical, fear, and pain-free training. I'm mentioning this to show not only that I care about the animal residents and the human residents of Cleveland Heights, but to back up what I am about to say, not only as an opinion, but based in scientific evidence. I want to thank Councilman Searin for continuing to push for legislation that better protects not only the animal residents, but the human residents as well. The proposed legislation will increase pet owner responsibility and further protect the animals from abuse and neglect. It will ensure more responsible pet owners move to Cleveland Heights. Breed-specific legislation, or better known as BSL, targets certain breeds or types of breeds of dogs based on looks, not behavior. Many cities, maybe even our own, instituted BSL under the guise of protecting the public. However, It is often based off of racist or classist ideals. To quote, keep out the dogs owned by people of color or poor people, and we will not have what we categorically do not like. It also misses the true mark on protections for human residents. I'm providing you with a handout from the American Veterinary Society of Animal Behavior. On the last page is an extensive list of studies that show BSL fails to ensure public safety and is difficult to implement. The listed research further goes to prove that how we treat and train or don't train our dogs is what leads to dog bites and attacks. All dogs, regardless of breeds, are capable of biting and attacking. The unfortunate thing is that media bias is what makes it look like dogs that could be visually identified as pit bull type dogs are the problem. Which means we believe somehow dogs such as golden retrievers, Labradors, and any of the mixed breed doodles that are currently so popular are still left to potentially bite and attack. I will be emailing you a sheet citing studies supporting this claim as well. All major ethical animal welfare organizations such as the ASPCA, Humane Society of the United States, the Association of Professional Dog Trainers, the Certification Council for Professional Dog Trainers, and the Pet Professional Guild and the Veterinary Society of Animal Behavior denounces breed-specific legislation and supports legislation that focuses on behavior, overlooks, and supports the humane treatment of these animals. I propose the City of Cleveland Heights adopt legislation that is like that of Lakewood, Ohio. Lakewood's new legislation addresses the root cause of dog bites and attack. The root causes of bites and attacks are based on fear, stress, and anxiety. Fear, stress, and anxiety are caused by a lack of training or improper training and training methods. Improper confinement or tethering, a lack of socialization, and finally, poor breeding. This holds true regardless of the breed or mix of dog. Along with the printed copy of the AVSAB position statement I have given you tonight, I will email you a copy of Lakewood's legislation. This legislation addresses improper use of training tools, which have been shown to increase stress, anxiety, and fear, proper tethering and management devices, and breed-neutral vicious dog ordinance. I am very willing to make myself available to further discuss how the treatment of dogs affect public safety. I want to thank you for your time this evening. I'm going to leave these up here for you.
Thank you for your comments.
I'm sorry?
Thank you.
Oh, I thought you said something.
I said thank you.
Thank you very much.
Did you wish to speak?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Kelly Zender, and I live at 3240 East Scarborough. I'm not a big believer in titles, but I need to do this. I'm the past president of Cleveland Stonewall Democrats. I'm a past president of Cleveland Pride, and I was involved in the steering committee with Heights Families for Equality. The reason I say this is because I was a little torn about issue 26. So I went on the website for No on 26, and I was absolutely appalled to see that the host of the website is Jimmy Hicks. He is a known homophobe. During the time that we went through Heights Families for Equality, he fought us every turn. He required the city to spend an incredible amount of money, I believe it was over $100,000, to pursue a lawsuit in which he was against the will of the people voting for the domestic partner registry. So, in my confusion at No on 26 or Yes on 26, it became very clear very quick who I was voting for, because I think you, being some people who are involved with No on 26, have made a large error in using Jimmy Hicks as a hoster of your website, as a spokesperson, and as somebody who is involved in fundraising. It goes against the core values of this city, and now I have become a pretty vocal proponent of Yes on 26. So I just thought that maybe you would want to hear from some of your citizens, because I am not the only one who feels this way, who are coming to a realization that no on 26 is backed by somebody who is pretty strong in hate. So I just wanted to share that, and thank you for listening.
So does anyone on council wish to comment?
I have the statement from the...
I'm not sure that Reverend Hicks is hosting.
If you go to the Facebook page, what comes up is hosted by Jimmy Hicks, and most of your of the posts on that website were put up by Jimmy Hicks. I'm not a huge Facebook person, but that was what I found in my...
That's false.
I'm just telling you what I saw on my computer.
I can tell you as a member of that committee.
I'm just telling you what I saw.
So we'll get to, you will be able to clarify that.
So I have a few.
So Councilperson Dunbar, you wanted to make a comment?
I did want to just say that none of us were on city council when the domestic partner registry was being considered. And in fact, I was at a very busy time in my professional career, so I only knew about that we had passed it. And it ultimately went into effect, and that was a good thing. Since I have been on council, I think there have been two pieces of legislation pertinent to the LGBTQ community. I'm only remembering the most recent one, which extended rights beyond the state's rights for employment and education. I have always consulted with Tom Nobie, a former colleague and friend, when LGBT issues have come up, and followed his advice, which has been to vote in favor of them. Tom was the executive director of the Gay Games when they were in Cleveland. He served on the vestry of St. Paul's Episcopal Church, a church we both attend, and he lives in Cleveland Heights on Hollister Road with his partner, David Ward. Jimmy Hicks has done a lot for the Caledonia neighborhood where his church is located. He has had programs for youth, especially in the summer, that keep them out of trouble and enable them to earn some money by mowing lawns, for example. His church runs a food bank, which helps people, especially elderly, have food to eat at the end of the month when their benefits run out. He has a Star Right Community Development Corporation. I heard him say at his church, which I went to once, not realizing what a huge time commitment Sunday service would be, that though he doesn't approve of same-sex marriage, LGBTQ people are our neighbors, friends, colleagues, and families, and we should love them. I do have a lesbian niece who is married in Massachusetts and has a daughter. My niece is a veterinarian who's been recognized for excellent teaching at one of the top veterinary schools in the country. We all love and admire her and her family. I did not know that Jimmy Hicks was going to be a spokesperson for the No on 20 Issue 26 meeting at the Noble Presbyterian Church until I arrived there. But the good government people have taken an official stance on the involvement of Jimmy Hicks, and I will read it to you. Our current council-manager form of government reflects the collaborative, welcoming, and tolerant character of Cleveland Heights. A progressive position is to vote no on issue 26 and prevent the consolidation of power in one person. While we respect the Stonewall Democrats, the proposed changes to our city charter have absolutely nothing to do with the LGBTQ... Well,
you're out of order.
I'm responding to the previous statement. So anyway, and no one's opinion should be stifled because of their religious beliefs. As a former councilman, religious leader, and activist in our community, Reverend Hicks' opinion on issues 26 is valid and should be heard. There should be no litmus test for supporters on either side, and everyone has a right to speak about how they prefer to be governed. So that's the end of the statement. The LGBTQ community has made huge progress in gaining acceptance over the past several decades. I hope it continues. We love diversity in Cleveland Heights, but diversity means we don't all think alike. We need to talk and listen to one another and understand one another, and sometimes to agree to disagree until something changes. So I love you all.
Mayor?
Councilperson Unger.
Thank you. Just very, very briefly, I don't consult with anybody on this issue. It's real simple for me. If it's good for the LGBTQ community, then I'm in favor of it. Simple as that. Never had a conversation with Jimmy Hicks about any LGBTQ issues. I've never had a conversation with Jimmy Hicks about issue 26. I had nothing to do with him being a spokesperson for issue 26. I suppose there's this amendment to the U.S. Constitution. It's called the First Amendment. It gives him the right to express his views, though I may vehemently disagree with him on those views if they've been accurately represented this evening, and I assume they have, but likewise he has that same First Amendment right to have views on issue 26, as everyone does. So simple as that. Thank you.
Councilperson Sarin.
Thank you. So I'm not going to editorialize too much about my own background and why I feel the way I do, but I'm a firm believer in all of our rights to express ourselves so long as our expressions don't cause violence to other people. And so I believe that everybody in this city, even people outside of our city, have the right to express how they feel about whether or not Cleveland Heights residents should be able to elect the head of the administrative branch of this government. So I wouldn't seek to restrict somebody's right to speak on this issue. At the same time, one of the reasons why I feel the way I do is because I believe that the implementation of policy is an extremely important part of our government, and how the implementation is undertaken should reflect the values of the people that live here. And so being in touch with those values is important. And that's why I happen to support and believe that an elected mayor would be a net benefit for this city. Just for example, I can't imagine any universe where this is even a possibility, but I would not be able to stop or prevent David Duke from endorsing my candidacy. If David Duke chose to do that for some wild reason, I couldn't stop him. I can't restrict his free speech. At the same time, I'm not going to invite him to one of my campaign events either. I just want to point that out. That speaks to the judgment, not of the person who is completely entitled to express their opinion, but of the people who would welcome that for whatever purposes and use it to advance their cause.
Did you want to, anyone else want to speak? While I acknowledge the concern that you have expressed, the proposed changes have nothing to do with the rights of anyone. And so I think, but we appreciate your coming and sharing your distress. Thank you very much.
Me now?
Yes.
You now.
Frankly, my name is Paul Volpe. I live at 2593 Fairmont Boulevard. I have a lot to say in a very short period of time. I'm here to speak about the severance proposal to hire a firm out of Pittsburgh called AE7. But I have to say, I've been here a few times in my time in Cleveland Heights, and I'm glad to hear a little bit of dialogue. There's not often that I get to hear council folks and regular citizens like me actually communicate with each other. We need more of that. And that's going to speak to what I'm going to talk about right now, specifically. We knew that a decision was made to send out an RFP. And incidentally, these are my personal views. These are no one else's views but mine. I'm speaking as a citizen and a practicing professional architect and urban planner. And I have some experience, like 40 years of it, and credibility in what I'm going to talk about. But I found out last week that you had a discussion in the Committee of the Whole, that there was a recommendation coming. I had also heard that tonight was going to be an emergency measure. You were going to vote on it. I just heard now that it is a first reading. Very glad to hear that. This is a very big deal. I support it strongly, investing this money. But how we invest it is tremendously important. And I will say, in my experience with the city, generally when things go awry, it's not what we do, it's how we do it. And that's my opinion about Top of the Hill. Strong supporter of it, always. Some people around this table know that. But it took way more effort than it should have to get where we ended up. And I don't want that to happen here. Severance is deteriorated, it's torn and tattered, it's a blight on our community, it's an enormous challenge, and it's a tremendous opportunity. It's both of those things. And if we don't get the right team in place, we're gonna screw it up. So as soon as I found out, I got into the website and I found the proposal, thank goodness. I started with the RFP, I started with the resolution. Totally open-minded on this. It says the proposal is based on the following criteria: recent history of similar successful high-impact urban planning projects. That's a selection criteria on your staff's part. Strength of experience of the proposed planning consultant team assigned to the project. I'm going to speak to those two things. There's much more to speak about, but we're going to talk about those two things. So I sat down. I read their proposal. I couldn't believe it. I didn't know whether to laugh or cry. And then I read it again to see if this was real. Seriously. I was a city architect for the city of Cleveland. I hired so many folks like this, and I've written more proposals like this specifically to these issues. I couldn't believe when I read. Then I got on their website. I want you to understand, I thoroughly investigated this. That's my job as a citizen. This is important to me. All I found was attractive, sexy words, generalities, and a ton of hyperbole, okay? And I can stand behind all of those literally with you, but I'm not gonna waste your time. What I'm gonna tell you is, the question is, are these people really qualified? And I'm gonna tell you they're not. Most of their work is retail-centric. They have almost no residential experience. They have very little city planning experience or urban design experience. Most of the work, they tout how much they've built, but virtually everything in their proposal and on their website is flashy renderings. And most of their projects are in Dubai, the Middle East, or other foreign places to the Midwest. Not one project in Ohio. In fact, the person working here said in his cover letter, "I found this hard to believe because, you know, I've had 35 years of working in Cleveland. I am proud to have played a role in shaping pieces." He's talking about remaking Cleveland and Pittsburgh. Their office is in Pittsburgh. He said, "I am proud to have played a role in shaping pieces of both places and helping transform their Rust Belt identities." I didn't see one example in everything I looked at of that substantiated that. That is hyperbole. So, there is no apparent track record at all in urban redevelopment. Real urban, I'm not talking about shopping centers in Dubai and shopping centers at Stapleton in Denver. I'm talking about, this is a hardcore urban redevelopment project. It's not gonna be easy. Fancy words aren't gonna make it happen. Pretty pictures aren't gonna make it happen. They have no local representation. Didn't we learn our lesson on Top of the Hill? Not a local person that knew this community, even from Cleveland, somebody that ate in a restaurant that had some sense of this wonderful community. We talk about how wonderful it is, and we can't hire somebody, an urban designer, to be on a team to help guide us through. They put a map in, one of their big selling points, inspiration for the project. They put a map in. Ohio City, the Flats, downtown, University Center, it's University Circle, it only is internationally renowned. And then they have Cleveland Heights Town Center. And they say, growth will happen from within the borders of the community. Cleveland Heights core needs to be a destination for those, quote unquote, who seek an alternative to her current hotspots in town. They don't know anything about this community, nothing. This is a mistake. I'm sorry. I'm passionate about it because it's my profession, okay? You don't go see a podiatrist to get brain surgery, okay? And this is who is recommended to do this project. We can do better. I heard there was 18 proposals. This one got picked? I couldn't think of a worse one. Their Cleveland office is in a house in Shaker Heights with a guy who just joined the firm and just opened the Cleveland office. Their supposed project manager, he touts how he travels all over the world doing these projects. What the hell is he going to do in our city?
So I really appreciate your passion.
So I get cut off and everybody else can talk?
Well, I've been timing.
Mary talked more than I did.
Mary is a member of council.
But I am a citizen, and this is supposed to be citizen comments. Thank you. Appreciate it. Mayor, I'm done. You get the message.
The message is that you totally disagree with the...
The message is, when I was going to finish in a minute, is that I was going to offer my assistance to help make the best decision for this community, so we don't rush into another thing here. Why you're rushing after all these months, I don't know, but I'm not allowed to talk, so I won't say anything, okay? Do what you want to do.
Thank you for your comments and your passion.
Can I respond? Can I respond from
Councilperson
Paul,
Unger?
Stay around for 1 second. Just as Chair of Planning and Economic Development, I appreciate what you've said. I can assure you, you're about to leave. We can talk later. But we're not going to rush this, okay? Questions were asked not as passionately as you just made the points, but questions were asked about this proposal at the Committee of the Whole meeting last week, last Wednesday night. More questions are going to be asked. This is going to be looked at very, very carefully. Your comments are going to be taken into account. Most assuredly, your input is welcome. The input of our CDC partner, Future Heights, which is certainly a conduit through which you can go, is going to be welcome. But we are not rushing in. I agree with everything you said. We are not rushing into this, if I have anything to say.
Mike, I appreciate that sincerely, right? Okay? And I am passionate, and I am a little bit angry. And the reason why is that at a first reading? Why is there, if there's more discussion, if you're going to engage with people like me that love this community and have the expertise that doesn't exist in City Hall and are willing and able to do this for nothing, and Futurites, why is it being read? I did hours of work, and Mary knows it, on severance 2 months ago. Pardon me?
You didn't fill out the RFP, that's why they didn't consider it.
All I know is that I'm trying to avoid making a mistake. And if there's a willingness to have a discussion and involve people that might help guide our city, that would be wonderful.
We do not wish to make a mistake. We're not going to make a mistake here. We're not going to rush it. And the technical answer to your question is it goes on for first reading because staff asks it to go on first reading. There's really nothing to prevent that. But the minute that it's before us, we as council get to look at it, especially when you're talking about $250,000, we're going to give it a good hard scrub. We're going to look at it. Questions have already begun to be asked almost precisely, as I told you in our email exchange, almost precisely along the lines that you discussed without any prompting from you and not across the street osmosis. Paul and I are neighbors, sir.
That's great to hear.
You would have thought that we've been talking.
Please invite me and Future Heights that you brought up to come to one of your planning and development meetings to discuss this. For 35 years, I worked in Northeast Ohio for probably 60 different communities. Nobody does it this way, okay? There are citizens advisory groups. There are outside advisors. There is a professional collaborative people, even in Chicago. The Mayor Daley's were famous for bringing in the best architects to advise them on selections. Okay, none of that happens here.
I don't want to get too much into it with you, but I made it clear, and I'm only one person on this council, I made it clear through my questions, if not my comments, last week that I wanted Future Heights side by side with us on this thing. We've got that. I think we as a council have that message loud and clear, and it's you'll see it happen. I believe you'll see it happen. Forget. Strike my last comment. I can't speak for the council. I believe we will. And thank you.
Thank you
for being here.
Over on this side. Okay.
Future Heights.
My name is Len Friedson. I live at 3065 Berkshire Road. Tonight, like you, I heard the comments by Kelly Zender, and I have some observations that I'd like to share with you about that. Kelly Zender was not demanding that you respond to her at this podium. She was giving you her opinion about something. I need to share with you that a bright red line does not exist between your personal lives and your professional lives. I think that Mary's reading of what I would agree with Gary on was a campaign announcement was totally inappropriate. So I would ask you, you all have your own individual free speech rights. Make sure, or I'm asking you to make sure, that you draw a line between your role as council people and as your individual opinions. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. In the back row, on this side.
About the First Amendment.
Gary Cantor, 3624 Cummings Road. I'm a private citizen speaking on my own behalf tonight. Before I start, so do I understand that the 5-minute time limit is suspended for the night?
It's actually 3 minutes and 30 seconds.
But that's been suspended for everybody so far, right? Okay, so let's get started. So the last time I spoke was July 29th. That was the night that the ballot issues were finally determined, put in ink. And Councilperson Unger, as he was voting with the majority that night, he said, in the interest of comity, and he repeated it because the word comity could sound like comedy, but he was talking about comity, a word I don't normally use, so I looked it up. And one definition is courtesy and considerate behavior towards others. Another definition is friendly social atmosphere, social harmony. Four of you, a quorum, a majority, created and funded a political action committee to support your views about city business. And that is the Cleveland Heights Citizens for Good Government. And you did that not in public, but you did it. And that was a quorum. And that's a violation of Ohio's open meeting laws. And as we saw from Councilperson Dunbar, there is no difference between city council and that campaign committee. You are one and the same. And I ask you, does putting up signs and having a website with the web address say no to political deals? Is that consistent with what the citizens elected you to do as their representatives on city council? In what way does this city benefit from those ghoulish, dishonest yard signs being in everybody's yard and in all over Facebook? You do not understand. I heard the words earlier, against the wishes of the citizens. Vice Mayor Yazanow was one of the two people representing No on Issue 26 when they interviewed with the Cleveland Plain Dealer editorial board for their endorsement. This city council, who was deliberating and voting on two charter amendments, had created and funded with $5,000 from four of you, and you had not disclosed it, and yet you were deliberating. And your plan was that nobody would know you had donated until August 1st, which was after the July 29th vote. And your plan was that we would never know until 12 days before the election, when those campaign reports come out, that the city manager lobby was putting up $25,000. If not for Mr. Cobb down there not voting with you, there would have been two ballot issues, the confusion, the four pages of language about the mayor, and we wouldn't have known anything about your friends donating $25,000. And now tonight, Councilperson Dunbar reads the campaign committee's statement during public record time, public address time. The last time I was here, I was incredulous that four of you hadn't resigned. And your behavior and your actions and your support of that filthy, dirty campaign committee continues. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Anyone else over here on this side in the back row? Moving to this side.
Stay with council.
Good evening, and thank you so much for the opportunity to speak. My name is Kyra Hall, and I live at 3450 Hartwood Road, and I've been a resident of Cleveland Heights for 4 years, and then I grew up in Shaker Heights. I am very excited about the new proposed legislation regarding possibly repealing the current breed-specific legislation targeted at pit bulls, and I also want to say I echo a lot of the points that I heard earlier. But I just wanted to speak today to many of the problems that I currently have with the legislation in place. And I think that there's a lot of positive things that can be done in order to make dog owners more responsible. And so currently, as was also mentioned earlier, this ordinance targets and discriminates against vicious dog owners. And the ordinance states that the owner of a vicious dog has a great responsibility to neighbors and to the public. Well, I believe that all dog owners have a responsibility, and that is to keep the public safe, themselves safe, and also their dogs safe. The breed-specific criteria. So this ordinance says that these requirements are put in place to reduce the likelihood of a bite, but it fails to address all the other dog breeds, aside from pit bull terriers, that are just as capable of biting or inflicting harm. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and the American Veterinary Medical Association state that there's no individual dog breed responsible for a greater number of bites. And in fact, they both rally behind responsible dog ownership as a key factor in reducing bites. There's also the misconception that pit bulls are vicious and can cause greater harm than any other breed, yet there's no credible evidence that pit bull mixes are more likely to bite and injure people. I also want to say I am a volunteer for the Cleveland Animal Care and Control Kennel, as well as an owner of two mixed breed dogs, and I have seen how anxiety and fear and, you know, the trauma that dogs have gone through can turn into their, you know, signs that seem like aggression, but it's really stemming from how people have treated them. And again, I have been with pit bulls and mixed dog breeds in a variety of settings and public settings with kids over the past year and a half. And these dogs are loyal, great companions, have shown no signs of aggression compared to other dogs. And breed identification is a really big problem with the current ordinance. There are a minimum of 20 dog breeds that possess the same physical traits that are labeled as pit bull. Pit bull is not recognized as a breed. This leads to inaccurate breed identification and difficulty enforcing breed bans against mixed breed. And, you know, for example, a dog might be referred to as a pit bull, but it might be a Jack Russell Terrier mix. It might have Boston Terrier. So we're labeling these dogs based on what they look like. And so, I mean, I really feel that we need the proposed legislation. I think I was really excited about it. And I think that it'll make, you know, put owners more responsible for the actions of their dogs and not punish responsible owners. Even if you have a dog that looks like a pit bull, you know, you should be treated equally. All owners should have equal rights and be held equally accountable. And so I'm very excited about this, and I hope that, you know, you take this into consideration when you vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your comments. Is there anyone else in the back row?
Good My name is Bob Jeffress, and I live at 2256 Delaware Drive. I'm here tonight to exercise my First Amendment rights and talk about Issue 26. The actual proposed charter amendment changes, and not the ballot language. The ballot language is a summary. If the public read and understood the actual changes, they would recognize the seeds of political corruption. The strong mayor advocates appear to prefer to create sideshows with misleading allegations and rumors, which divert public attention away from the actual changes. The actual amendment states, quote, "The mayor shall appoint, promote, transfer, reduce, or remove all officers and employees of the city," unquote, and, quote, "The mayor may remove the director of any department without the approval of council," unquote. Thus, on day one, the strong mayor could fire every department head, or whole departments for that matter, and replace them with politically connected friends. For example, the mayor could fire the police chief and the fire chief and replace them with politically connected friends. The council would have no say, only appointees appointed by the strong mayor. The strong mayor advocates would have you believe there is accountability with the charter changes. Yes, after 4 very long years, the citizens of Cleveland Heights would get to weigh in on a matter of any firings or political appointments. We've seen in other cities how bad it can get before the damage is done. The voters learn the price tag and are able to actually vote to make a change. Always the voter gets left to pick up the price tag. The charter amendments usurp our municipal court with, quote, "The mayor shall have all the judicial powers granted by the general laws of Ohio to mayors of city," unquote, which allows not only for the mayor to fix traffic tickets, but also to pocket money from marrying couples. The strong mayor advocates would have you focus attention on other sideshow issues, such as alleged money hidden in some water fund years ago, which is not only false, but laughable. Consider simply that the city is audited every year. I urge voters to read the actual charter amendments and to ask questions of why this or that change. I believe that if you act with intelligence and wisdom, you will join me in voting no on Issue 26 on November 5th and send a message that we are united in diversity and tolerance, tolerant for different opinions. Thank you.
Could I make a statement?
So, okay. Please. Is there anyone else after Mr. Kuda? I was just going to suggest that you line up so we could.
I'm Tony Kuda. I live at 3561 Fenley Road. Fenley. Wow. It's kind of like almost hard to get started. So what you just heard is the fear-mongering that's been going on for the past several months. The language in the amendment regarding hirings and firings is the same exact language the city manager has in her charge. She can do the same things. But here's the thing. I'd like to know, I know there's 4 donors up here for the issue no on 26. Have all of you seen the press release that was given out by the campaign that you're funding? Have you all seen the press release that came out this weekend? Khalil, did you see it?
I did, yes.
Ms. Rowe?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Ms. Dunbar?
I believe so.
Pardon me?
I don't believe so.
Same, I'm not sure.
I've seen it.
Okay. So it's hard to believe that they wouldn't send that press release to their supporters, but let's just say they didn't.
Well, now you're asking a different question. Was it cleared to me? The answer is absolutely not. Did I have anything to do with it? Absolutely not.
Oh, no, I know.
That's a different story.
No. I know you didn't. I know you didn't write it or anything. I just wanted to know if you saw it.
Let's be clear about something.
Yes.
All I did is contribute to this to express my views. I've been against issue 26 and whatever iteration it is for a long time. That's it. It's as simple as that. You can get up here, you can spin whatever kind of conspiracy.
I'm not spinning anything. I'm just asking if
you've seen it. Well, your predecessors have, there's innuendo here.
No, I don't have predecessors.
I have a lot of respect for you, but I've been really clear, okay, on what I've done and why I've done it. It's as simple as that. I have a lot of respect for you.
Okay.
I have a lot of respect for the pro issue 26 folks, and I have a lot of respect for the voters. And no matter how they come down, I'm going to respect it, and we're going to effect it.
So here's my point.
I've said that from the get-go.
Here's my point.
But that's all that's going on here. It's not some grand conspiracy. It's four members of council who are expressing their views. Simple as that.
Point of order. Can we not have
this? I'm not even intimating that. I'm just trying to find out if you saw it, because my question is that, you know, a lot of this campaign is about leadership and accountability. We've talked about it over and over again. This gentleman that was talking about his house is trying to find out where the buck stops. I think a lot of people who are voting for issue 26 want to know exactly where the buck stops. They want accountability and they want leadership. And what I'm hoping for is if I gave $1,000 to a campaign and they were spewing out lie after lie, I would want to stand up as a person that was elected and speak out against those kind of things that came
so
out.
So wait a minute.
Out, I would want to speak up about those things that came out, because
I think there's been hyperbole on both sides, and I think this is not the place.
It's not a wash, but the two of you, Mayor Rowe and Councilman Unger, we sat down and had a three-hour conversation about this, I'd say 8 months ago, probably.
We did.
Okay? You know exactly how this group was formed, and there was a press release that came out with something completely different. And what I'm looking for, just as a citizen, certainly as a person that's working on the campaign, but as a citizen, I want to see our leaders stand up just for civility, for fairness, for, you know, not supporting misrepresentations. That's all I want to see. If you haven't seen it, then,
you haven't seen it.
You haven't seen it. I understand that.
I don't support misrepresentations.
Okay, and I would expect that. But I would expect when you do look at this that you do make statements that support what
because you disagree with them. So
No, this is not a disagreement about...
I understand, but, you know...
No, this is not a disagreement about, that I'm on one side of the issue, they're on the other side of the issue.
So you're at 5 minutes now.
Yeah, I'm done. Thank you for listening.
Oh, God.
Susan Miller, I live at 3165 Berkshire Road, and it's come to my attention that there's a rumor out there that there was no, and I don't know where this number came from, $5 million deficit in the water fund. And some of you were on council and know that I spent hours and days, I spent 40 hours a week for an entire freaking year. We finally have the packet released to the public, because our committee member on the Citizens for Cleveland Public Water in Cleveland, you know, making the transition to Cleveland Water, we spent hours doing research, doing the math for the transition to Cleveland Water, and to have a political campaign just outright state that there was no $5 million deficit. I mean, there's an interim finance guy who was at Committee of the Whole this evening, and I asked him, can I call you later in the week and find out where we are on paying that down? Because we don't get regular updates. But as I recall, and this number hangs in my mind and was reported in the press, $3.7 million, can anybody confirm? Or were you guys asleep during that? $3.7 million deficit, no, $2.2 million deficit $3.7 million debt and $900,000 in repairs that were in arrears to Cleveland Water. So I'm just looking for a confirmation that we did in fact have a debt and a deficit. I have seen in reviews of Mr. Downey from 2012, 10, and 9 that there was concern on council at that time about the water and sewer funds becoming anxiously low and scary. So I know this is before some of you were on council, but certainly by January of 2015, we knew that we had a debt, a deficit, and arrears, and something needed to be done. So I'm asking you, in the same vein as Tony asked you about being involved with a campaign that is making claims that are simply either untrue or obfuscations of semantics. We did have a debt, a deficit, and a problem. We have 60% of our water leaking out underground here in Cleveland Heights. Many people don't know this. We are paying a transition fee. We could stand here and parse the semantics of hidden for a long time that I don't want to stand here, but I'm asking for council to clarify the water issue.
Madam President, if I could just briefly make a statement about that.
Councilperson Sarin.
Thank you. I won't take too much time. I know that out of the five of us here at this dais, only two of us were there sort of at during some of that time. I joined council in February of 2015. So I was quickly thrust into this discussion. And I definitely remember having a lot of conversation about arrears. And there was even some discussion about some balance of arrears that the city owed, that the city of Cleveland owed the city of Cleveland Heights, and that the city of Cleveland Heights owed the city of Cleveland, and we were trying to come to some agreement about how that would be structured, and it turned out that we owed them more than they owed us, if I remember correctly. This is not something, from my memory, that should be a controversial thing. It's a fact. I mean, controversial in terms of its creation, but not controversial in terms of the fact that it was real. Mary, back me up here if you remember that as well.
We definitely had a deficit. I don't remember numbers as big as what you're reporting, Susan. I think it was $1 million is what I heard. But
I can send you the document.
Okay. And after...
You can look them up yourself because you were involved in those meetings.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's what I remember from long ago.
I think the city manager, who isn't here, has looked into this $5 million figure, and I believe she can provide some guidance and has some calculations that have been done. And I will ask her to do that as soon as she comes back.
So next week we should see that in the packet?
Oh, she's only back on Friday.
I don't believe it would be completed by Friday because that's when it goes in the packet, probably the following week.
Okay, is there anyone else who wishes to speak? Thank you all for coming, and you're very welcome to stay, but I know that in many instances, people like to leave now, so if you would like to leave now, it will be okay with us, or you can stay.
So sad what's going on. Very sad. Oh, yeah. Poor city. Yeah, me too. I totally agree.
All right, so we're on item number 6 on the agenda. The report of the Vice City Manager and Clerk of Council.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm just going to mention a few things for the community to be aware of. Number one, I apologize for any confusion over the shredding day date. It was on October the 12th, and even though October 19th had been in the March focus, a few weeks after that, we knew it had to be on the 12th, and so we did our best effort to get that word out, and there were some residents that didn't know the change in date, and I apologize for their frustration and confusion over that. Secondly, leaf pickup starts on November 4th, and that will be on the city's website. You know, every year we put a map there of the different zones. It starts on November 4th, and early December is when it ends. But depending on the fall and how the leaves literally fall, we will be considering extending that a little bit, as we have done in past years. And then I want the community to be aware, because we have gotten calls. We are very conscientious about Census 2020. We know that our funding is dependent on our population number and our demographics. So we have a coalition committee formed of the schools, library, League of Women Voters, and our own staff people. And I will be working together using materials from the federal census that are online for us. And also, we will definitely be using every means we can in terms of promotion to make sure everyone is fairly counted. And if they need assistance, we will be there to help them. And then finally, just in case anybody drives by Severance Center tomorrow, the Russo brothers are shooting a movie in Cleveland Heights, and they started out this morning at Forest Hill Park. Tomorrow they're going to be all over Severance Center, so you'll see movie cars, big trucks and vehicles and actors. And next Monday they will be at Coventry Road on Lancashire and Hampshire. So it's kind of exciting. We are home to the arts. And it's nice to know the Russo brothers acknowledge that. So those are a few comments. And then I will switch over now to be clerk of council and read into the record. I am notifying council that a notice has been received from the Ohio Department of Liquor Control advising that an application has been made by Elise Bistro LLC, 219597 Lee Road, Cleveland Heights, Ohio, 44118, for a transfer of a D5 permit from safekeeping of 19th Whole Bar and Grill LLC, Western Plaza, first floor and patio, 2101 Park Road, Springfield, Ohio, 45504, and notifying council of this notice and a matter of record.
So this matter will be referred to the Safety and Municipal Services Committee, the City Manager, and the Director of Law. No other action is needed at this time.
Correct.
Do you have anything else to
report? No, thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. Committee reports, Housing and Transportation Committee, Councilperson Dunbar.
There's no legislation to report, and I have nothing to say.
Thank you. Planning and Development Committee, Councilperson Unger.
Yes, one matter this evening, thank you. Resolution 93-2019, subject of discussion a bit ago. This is a resolution that would authorize the city manager to enter into an agreement with AE7 Pittsburgh LLC concerning the Severance Town Center redevelopment plan project. It is about to be amended courtesy of Councilman Sarin, to remove the emergency aspect that's currently appended to it.
Move to amend ordinance number 93-2019 to remove the emergency clause by deleting the clause at the beginning in the title, declaring it an emergency, and deleting section 3 from the legislation.
Second.
Is there any discussion?
Cobb?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Rowe?
No.
Surin?
Aye.
Unger?
Aye.
4 ayes, Your Honor.
The motion has passed.
That's it. Thank you. Nothing else to report.
Thank you. Recreation, Community, and External Relations Committee.
Thank you, Madam President. I don't have any legislation, but I would like to just speak briefly about some issues that are bringing me some concern and consternation as we debate some really important matters in our city. I think we are all, and we've all been passionate about how we would like to improve the city of Cleveland Heights. We don't always agree. And I've seen in the case of this particular debate about how we govern ourselves, a great deal of passion, but unfortunately, I've seen some of that passion spill over into aggression in a way that I think is not healthy. Not healthy to the discourse on the particular issue, and not healthy to the discussions that we should all be having with each other as members of the same community. I've said to you privately, I've said publicly, and I will continue to say that I wholeheartedly and strongly support any individual council member's efforts to express how they feel about any given issue and to work for their own political goals. People don't have to ask my permission to pursue their goals. I believe that we are all residents in addition to being council members, and we have a stake in the success of this city as we see it. And so I will always stand up for all of our rights to free speech and expression. I will always stand up for our rights to propose and work toward the policy goals that we think are important. I know that in this circumstance, things can get blurry sometimes when, you know, in this case, there are, you know, a collection of supporters that also happen to be on this council of a particular issue. And there is a difference between the business of the city and the business of a campaign committee. And I know that in this case, because that campaign committee has so much to do with how we operate here as a city, that questions of whether it's city business or committee business to strategize about how to address, say, the ballot language, that's the sort of thing that can get a little blurry. And so, of course, I always caution both myself and all my colleagues to be very aware of sunshine law things. You know, this is a sticking point for me. I'm always very interested in that. So be aware of that. Guard against the possibility that we could be entering into dangerous realms. I do it myself. I second guess myself because it's important to do so. But at the same time, I will always defend each of your rights to express yourself on these issues in the same way that I would defend former colleagues of ours, County Councilwoman Cheryl Stevens, for instance, whether or not she has any interest in some other political office is, you know, I don't feel that I have the place to tell her or anyone else that they should or should not have spoken with residents about either a general change in our government or a specific change because she wanted to run for an office. And so I worry that when we start attempting to restrict people who are in political office from having conversations with their constituents about running for a political office, I'm not sure where that trail leads, frankly. So I think that we should be aware of that too. And I don't know if how closely or if you have seen the most recent publication from one of the campaign committees. Just to put it bluntly, it basically, in my view, accuses our state representative, Jeanine Boyd, of misusing public resources. And I thought, frankly, that was astonishing to me. I know that these things can get very contentious. And as we've seen at the national level, politics can be very destructive. I did not expect that here. I hope that you do read that press release that went out, and I hope you have the same reaction that I did. I think it's dangerous. I think that it is should be of concern to all of us whether or not we agree that an elected mayor would be beneficial for the city. Because the question of the discourse and the question of how we relate to each other and interact with each other is a separate question from how we govern our administrative branch. This is something that I think will last into the future in a way that we might not anticipate. I really hope that we can bridge these gaps no matter what the election results are. But this is something that I don't think is acceptable, this kind of behavior, this kind of political behavior. I think that we as a community should reject that kind of accusation. Certainly, as far as I can tell from what was provided by the campaign in that news release, unfounded accusations of misconduct. And when I asked about it, the spokesman for the committee said, oh, we're not accusing anyone of a crime, but then there's no correction made in the news release that actually accused somebody of what could be considered a crime. This is something that we need to take care of as a city, I suppose that the people who produce the news release are ultimately responsible for the contents. But as a city, this is something that we need to make sure that we address in a more holistic way, because this is destructive and damaging. So I really hope that you guys can join me in that. Even if we disagree on sort of the underlying issue, we can have that debate about the underlying issue without sinking into these kind of tactics.
So I'm not clear. Are you accusing us of, quote, sinking into these kinds of tactics?
I honestly don't know if you had anything to do. I mean, you've said you had nothing to do with it. So no, I'm saying
that we didn't write it. I can only speak for myself. I didn't write it. I didn't review it. I don't have anything to do with it.
As I said, anybody who is responsible for the campaign committee
taking the microphone, I would have told you before you took the microphone.
Of course, anybody who is responsible for this campaign committee and directs its actions, those are the people who need to account for the accusations that are in that news release.
Are you responsible for everything that's coming out of the Citizens for Elected Mayor?
I am not affiliated with the Citizens for the Elected Mayor campaign.
Have you contributed any money?
I have not contributed any money.
Time, anything to
it? I have not volunteered for them. I have not contributed any money. I support the issue.
Okay.
I am not a member of their campaign.
So
I have not contributed to their campaign. I'm not responsible for what their campaign does. I did that deliberately. But I know that you guys have the option and the right to join a campaign. I am not taking that away from you. I made a different choice. That is not to say that your choice was wrong. What I'm saying is that whoever is responsible for what was stated in that news release should be called to account for it.
I haven't seen it.
So if I contribute to the Biden campaign and the Biden campaign puts out a news release with which I disagree, I own it. Am I clear? Is that your view?
I thought I made myself clear that whoever is responsible for the creation of that news release is responsible for the creation of that news release.
Why are you directing it this way, Councilman Sarin?
Well,
directing those comments this way?
Well, as a body, I think that
Why would you do that?
Would you like for me to answer your question, or would you like for me to start answering your question and be interrupted?
Why didn't you ask us the question before you took the microphone? Why didn't you do it that way? Why didn't you ask me? We were just together at the Committee of the Whole meeting. Why didn't you ask me the question?
Okay.
And likewise, ask each of your colleagues the question so you could have the answer before you take the microphone and make your inflammatory statements.
Would you like an answer to your question?
Accusations launched our way when you have no basis for doing so. You
Councilman
can answer
Unger,
any question you want, but I'm
Madam President, please.
I think that
was I making a statement during my committee report, please?
This is an example of ridiculous. How we all need to take a deep breath and step back and think about how we are going to all come together 2 weeks from now. And if anybody has suggestions for that, we could start thinking about it right now.
Madam President,
and
I'm not done with my committee report. Can I please finish?
I thought you were commenting on things beyond your committee report.
Okay, so when people make announcements in their committee reports that are not necessarily related to legislation or the topics of their committee reports, they are not allowed to do so? Or what, could I finish my statement, please?
Please finish your statement.
Okay, thank you.
And then we will move to the Safety and Municipal Services Committee.
So to further clarify, as is obviously necessary, I was not accusing you, council member, of anything inappropriate. As you mentioned in the conversation earlier, you did not write it, you did not review it. I recognize that. Now, to speak to the point of how do we find a solution to this rift that this environment has caused, one of the ways is for us as, I mean, I would say our roles probably provide us some measure of leadership in the community, and certainly our roles as either, you know, funders, members, something of a campaign committee, we can influence people to own up to their mistakes and try to make it right before it goes too far. So in this case, I think that the obvious choice is sort of a truth and reconciliation where people who have made accusations against people that are unfounded can walk those back and apologize. Now, I'm not saying that you guys have the influence to make that happen on that campaign committee, but you might, or you could try. I don't have those connections. Those aren't people that reach out to me and respond. So if you do, I'm asking you to engage with them and help with that. Thank you.
I believe that the former city manager of this city has been accused of issues that probably, maybe there's an apology, if there's going to be apologies, that maybe there's an apology that should take place there. Can we move to the Safety and Municipal Services Committee?
Yes, we can, and I will limit my remarks to the Safety and Municipal Services Committee matter. We have one ordinance, ordinance number 24-2019, and this was the subject of discussion earlier concerning our animal ordinances and our changing the code to do away with the prior definition of dangerous dog. An ordinance repealing Part 5 General Offenses Code of the Codified Ordinances of Cleveland Heights, Chapter 505, Animals and Fowl of the Codified Ordinances, and adapting a replacement Chapter 505, Animals and Fowl. The entire ordinance is posted on our website, and I would note that it is not an emergency measure. This is a first reading. That's all that I have.
Do you have anything else that you would like to relate?
No, I don't.
Okay. There is no report from the Administrative Services Committee. Councilperson Stein is not able to be here, as reported earlier. Finance Committee?
Nothing to report.
So, I think that it's very late. It's 9:10, and I think that I will forego the mayor's report. I do believe that we all need to take a deep breath and think about how we are going to get through the next 2 weeks in a civil manner and think about whether or not we should have ideas about a reconciliation process after this election is over. And anyone who has any thoughts about that should send them to me at this point, I guess, because I am the mayor and I don't know if I'm the right person or who would be the right person to lead a reconciliation process. But it's very clear to me, which I said in my comments at a candidate forum a couple of weeks ago, that I think that that will be an essential thing for us as a community. We are a passionate community. Everybody has ideas, and in the end, we will all come together, and I have confidence in the citizens of Cleveland Heights. With that, this meeting is adjourned.